our musicians. If you'd take your Bibles then, take your Bibles and we'll turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And if you're able, would you stand together as we read the scriptures this morning? We'll read this passage here. Passage I've had in my preparations notes for quite some time, and sometimes I'll have messages that just kind of stir around in my head for weeks or months or even years, and then one day I feel like it's a good time and the Lord moves me in that area. We're going to be looking at this passage. We're going to read through probably half of the chapter, but we're not going to look at it all tonight. We're just going, this morning rather, we're going to look at the first couple of verses, but then we're going to go over the rest over a number of weeks as we look at the subject of the ministry. 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 1, "Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mystery of God." Mysteries of God. "Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. But with me it's a very small thing that I should be judged of you or of man's judgment. Yea, I judge not mine own self, for I know nothing by myself. Yet am I not hereby justified, but he that judgeth me is the Lord. Therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord come, who both will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the hearts, and then shall every man have praise of God. And these things, brethren, I have in a figure transferred to myself and to Apollos for your sakes, that you might learn in us not to think of men above that which is written, that none of you should be puffed up for one against another. For who maketh thee to differ from another? Or what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it? Now you are full, now you are rich, now you've reigned as kings without us. And I would to God you did reign, that we also might reign with you. For I think that God has set forth us the apostles last, as it were appointed to death. For we are made a spectacle unto the world, and to angels, and to men. We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise. We are weak, but you are strong. You are honourable, but we are despised. Even unto this hour, this present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and are naked, and are buffeted, and have no certain dwelling place, and labour, working with our own hands. Being reviled, we bless. Being persecuted, we suffer it. Being defamed, we entreat. We are made as the filth of the world and are the offscouring of all things unto this day. I write not these things to shame you, but as my beloved sons, I warn you. For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have ye not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus have I begotten you through the gospel. Therefore I beseech you, be ye followers of me. For this cause have I sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son, and faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways, which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere in every church. Now some are puffed up, as though I would not come to you, but I will come to you shortly, if the Lord will, and will know not the speech of them which are puffed up, but the power. For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. What will ye? Shall I come unto you with a rod, or in love and in the spirit of meekness?" In the first two verses, again, "Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and as stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are thankful for your word. And we ask that you'd stir our hearts through it, bless and encourage us as we consider these thoughts, and that we might be faithful servants of God. And Lord, we pray that you'd move us to that end. That is our desire. And we ask that you'd work a willingness that we would be responsive to that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. As we go on further weeks, this passage yields a lot of different thoughts. We have a thought about accountability in ministry, which is a good thing. There's a little section in that passage which deals with the gifting for ministry, which is a good thought. There's a part of his appeal that he speaks of the cost of ministry, and we'll speak a week looking at that. There are appearances in ministry we need to be very careful of and consider those things. And then there are some responses in ministry that we also need to be careful in our usage of those things. But this morning we're going to look at something a little bit different. We're going to look at the privilege of ministry. The privilege of ministry as Paul looked at the reality that he was a minister of the gospel. A minister of the gospel. Now, most appropriately, this passage is for the preacher. Paul was talking to the church in Corinth, but he was reflective of himself and his position as a minister of the gospel. So I can preach to Phil and for later on for Fernand. But I think by principle, we want to understand what I would like to see this morning is that we are all given to a purpose of the ministry of the gospel. And to differing degrees as parts of the body of Christ, we are ministers of the gospel. Now, that may not be what you do for a living, so to speak, but it ought to be our life. It ought to be our endeavor, every one of us, that we are indeed ministers of the gospel. A man went to the doctor and he said to the doctor, "Look, I've got a problem with snoring. I really need you to help me." And the doctor said to him, "Why does it bother your wife?" And he says, "My wife? Well, it bothers the whole church." Sometimes people have all kinds of issues, and maybe it wasn't just the snoring that he needed to deal with there. Maybe he needed to stay awake in church. Church yields a lot of information about people, doesn't it? Church life is people life. It's all about us, the Lord's people. Is that me doing something wrong there? Okay, we'll see. Sorry about that. Good. All right. Yeah, church life is something that every believer wants to be a part of, wants to be a member of, and the Bible speaks of the body of Christ, and each one being a member of the body, and thereby being able to fulfill his role. 1 Corinthians 12 deals with the differences of members, and again, we'll look at that at a different time. But one of the great things that we see here, Paul uses that term, ministers of Christ. I want to start with this thought, and that is, what a privilege it is to be accounted as one who is a minister of Christ. As an appointment, that is an exalted position. Now, we have people who fight and squabble and go to the greatest degrees to be able to be a member of parliament, or maybe to be a leader of a group in parliament, maybe to be the prime minister or whatever. And there's all kinds of backstabbing and everything to get the position. What they want is a role. They want the appointment. Some people want lucrative appointments to different jobs, maybe to be a representative for Australia in a foreign country like in New York or something like that. The appointment might be something that they're going to squabble and fight over and do all kinds of things to get into and get themselves in trouble for. If you know the Lord Jesus Christ today, you can say, I am a minister of Christ. That's a wonderful place to be in. Do you like your employer? Just be a little bit careful there. How about if you were a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ? That's a pretty good employer, don't you think? You think he treats his employees well? Absolutely. He's no pushover. He's not going to take sleepy laborers. He wants you to do what you're supposed to do. We can't go to sleep at the wheel when Christ is our master, but we must recognize that we serve the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and there is no greater appointment than we have. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 11, Paul says this of himself, whereunto I am appointed a preacher and an apostle of the Gentiles. And he was recognizing that God has given me the best job in the world. Now, for a preacher, or to a preacher we might say, you have the highest calling that involves some of the hardest realities of life. You deal with the highlights and the lowlights. You get the height and you get the depth. You get both ends of the spectrum. They come with that. You know, if you're a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, whose task it is to bear forth the gospel of Christ, that comes with a great perspective there, a fantastic appointment. We stand as his ambassadors and his representatives, and it comes with all that runs with that as well, which might be rejection for Christ's sake. But let's start with this. What an appointment. When the Lord Jesus gave the Great Commission to the local church, he said, you shall be witnesses unto me. Not you might be, not you could if you really wanted to be. This is my purpose for you. You might not feel called to preach, but you are called to be a representative of the Lord Jesus Christ. And what a wonderful thing that is. Well, let's go beyond the appointment and look then at the assignment. He says there we're ministers of Christ, and then he goes on and he says we are stewards. Now, what is a steward? A steward is something that holds something that is not his own. He's given a task of fulfilling a duty in a role which deals with somebody else's business. The very clearest thing we can see in Scripture of that is Joseph. And I love the picture of Joseph as a faithful steward. Remember, he was made to be a steward in Potiphar's house. He started off a lowly servant. You know what? When he was a steward, he was just a lowly servant with a job that was somewhat elevated, but he was to take care of all of Potiphar's goods for Potiphar's benefit. Just being a servant, but it was something for somebody else. And you know, the Bible tells us that when he was there as the steward in Potiphar's house, everything that he did, God made it to prosper, and God blessed that house because he had a right spirit towards God and he was a faithful steward. And God used him as a steward. Do you know, after that, he got a new assignment from God? You say, I thought he got lied about and sent to prison. Yeah, do you know what he became after that? He became a steward in the prison. The Bible tells us that the jailer, that nothing happened in the jail unless Joseph was the doer of it. And he was the one that had the charge of everything that was happening. He was a steward in the prison. Yes, he was a prisoner, but he was a steward. And he was running business for somebody else. You know, it was from there that he became the servant of Pharaoh. And as the servant of Pharaoh, he was a steward of Pharaoh's business. And he told Pharaoh what he ought to do and how they ought to lay aside during the good years, and then they could give it out during the bad years. And this was his advice. And he said, you need to get some wise man and put them over the business. And Pharaoh said, well, there's nobody else like you. Let's get you to do the job. Do you know, if Pharaoh had have said, guys, let's take a vote. Who would like to be the one who runs all of my business, deals with all of my accounts, gets first pick in everything and directs it all? There would have been about 1 million hands went up. Everybody would have said, make me Pharaoh's steward. Not so many would have been keen in Potiphar's house, but probably there may still have been a few. And I doubt there would have been any in that jail who would have said, make me the guy that runs the jail from the inside. Not many volunteers would have come if we were to ask for that. Being a steward is good and it's bad. It has its high days and it has its low days. It has days where Joseph gets to tell one guy that he's going to be restored to his position, and it has days where he has to tell another guy, well, you're going to be off with your head. That's the end of you. We're appointed to a task. So if you're a steward of God, we need to take that seriously. I think that's why God was able to bless Joseph, because he took his stewardship seriously. And it didn't matter where it was or to whom it was. He was faithful in the small things. He could be made accountable in greater things. God could give him greater things to do. In 1 Peter 4, we're reminded there in verse 10, as every man has received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Have you received God's grace? If you're saved, you know something of the reality of his grace, his gift to you, his goodness to you. Having received the grace of God in my life, God now says, I am a steward of the grace of God. So what I have received, I need to give. And so he would tell us, freely you have received, freely give. And he's not just talking about money, though that might come into the equation, or time, or our love. He's talking about the gospel of Christ, the grace of God. We are stewards of the gospel. Now, if Pharaoh came to his steward and said, we had really good crops this year, but we don't have much in our coffers, Joseph would have been found wanting. I wonder if our master came to us and said, the gospel is just as real as it was in the day it was given. How are you going with that? Have you been a faithful steward of the grace of God? And we would have to consider that and ask ourselves the question, have we been faithful in sharing the gospel of Christ? As a steward, as a preacher, we need to be asking preachers, have you been faithful in preaching the word? Oswald Smith said, the world does not need sermons, it needs a message. That's an interesting thought, because we don't want just something to touch our ears, we want something that's going to touch our heart. And that has to have the power of God and his word behind it. He said, you can go to seminary and learn how to preach sermons, but you have to go to God to get messages. Some of you guys have at times preached a message. And there's a difference between going online and downloading somebody else's message and preaching it and going to God and getting a message from God. And when God gives us a message, it's a different thing. It doesn't mean that we're the perfect preacher, but it ought to mean that we have the anointing of God on our ministry as we go on. We have an assignment. We are stewards. How's your stewardship of the gospel? And then we have an authority. He speaks here, we're stewards of the mysteries of God. Now, it's one thing for a steward to be given grain, as in Joseph's sense, or even the other prisoners while he was in jail. It's one thing for a steward to be given the accounts or the runnings of a business or whatever it might be. But if somebody would come and give us the mysteries of eternity, the eternal questions, if you like, the mysteries of God. Wow, that's pretty good. That's pretty big. That's something quite amazing. The Bible speaks of the angels who desire to look into these things of the gospel. They don't get it. Why would God do that? Sinful men. Why would Jesus become a man? He's God. And these things are questions. You know, the mystery in the scripture is something which is previously hidden, but now revealed. And God takes and reveals mysteries. The mystery of the gospel was the wonder that Christ, the God-man, would die for us. That for the first 2,000 years of history, the first 4,000 years of history, that was hidden. There were glimpses of it. There were promises of it. Right back from Adam's time, we had the promise of the work of Christ and the gospel. But with the resurrection of Christ, God brushed aside the curtains and made very clear the plan of eternal salvation for mankind. And he gives to us an authority in the gospel. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we read, after that, in wisdom, the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Worldly people get all kinds of wisdom. They learn, they study. It does my head in, but they'll go to university and study theology when they don't even know God. And they can learn about God and they can learn about all of those things, but the world by wisdom knows not God. And then God says, I'm going to do something here. Through the foolishness of preaching, I'm going to save them that believe. In the truest sense, you get a preacher behind the pulpit and God has authorized his ministry to preach the gospel. And you know what? In just as true a sense, as you take that gospel with you to work or to your neighborhood or to your family or to your friends or to your place of learning, wherever you go in life, you are authorized as stewards of the mysteries of God, and the gospel is your authority to share with anybody, anywhere. God's given that to you. It's a pretty fantastic thing to be accounted as ministers of Christ, isn't it? That we can take the gospel and preach the gospel to lost people. 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 23 tells us we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, unto the Greeks foolishness, but unto them which are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And what he says is, as we preach a dead Christ, but we preach a risen Christ. And to some, they don't want to know Christ. It's a stumbling block. And to others, that's foolishness. Why would he do that? But those who have a desire after God and those who choose to believe, it's the power of God to them. You carry with you the authorization of God, the power of God unto salvation. No prime minister has that. No CEO has that power. He might think he's got a pretty cushy deal. He might be bringing in tens of millions of dollars every year. He can't even take it to eternity with him. He's going to leave it all behind. But you have something which you can invest and use for the glory of God and take it to heaven with you. Because the power of God is unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. And you have that in your hands. God gave it to you. It's your authority. That's what we have as believers. Wow. 1 Peter 4 and verse 11. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. Why don't we turn over there? Preacher, what are you going to preach? 1 Peter 4:11. For the preacher, often his question is, what shall I preach? Well, make sure it's the word of God. What are you going to put on your bumper sticker? I love my church. That's not your message. That's not your message. This scripture says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. You know what? We've got something here. That's your only message. That is the sum total of your message. You don't have to make it sound good. You don't have to shave off the edges so it's acceptable to people. This is our authority. We're going to take the word of God. We're going to share that with people. If any man minister, he's the minister of Christ. Let him do it as of the ability which God gives. Some of you have the gift of the gab. Be careful that you don't trust self as you present Christ. You need to come back and trust the word of God. Some of you haven't got the gift of the gab, and you're afraid to share anything. You know what? We stand on the same terms. God put his word in my hand and in my heart, and I can take that and I can use that with the power of God. I am authorized to preach the word. Do it as of the ability which God gives, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. God ought to be glorified as we share. God ought to be the center of attention when we preach the gospel. We're called to a purpose. Let's not be too concerned about the snoring. Let's get down to business with the staying awake. Let's get to the things that really matter. Let's work on what our objective and our job is all about. So we are ministers of Christ. Furthermore, we are stewards. We are stewards of the mysteries of God and carry all the authority of that. But I want you to look in verse number 2 as we consider this. It is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. It's good to think of our appointment and to rejoice in that. What a privilege that God would take sinners and make them his representatives. He could have had angels down here heralding the gospel, but he took sinners. And you know why? Because you have tasted of the grace of God in a way that an angel can never. If you know Christ and his forgiveness, God's given you an appointment. He's given us an assignment, stewardship. He's given us the authority.
But we need to consider our approach. What am I doing with this? How am I using this authority that God has given me? Is it so that I can strut around and say, hey, I'm the steward of God. I've got something you haven't got. Let's be careful of our approach. He said it ought to be that a steward be found faithful. I want you to turn over with me, if you would, to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. And here we've got a little message to a preacher. It's Paul speaking to Timothy as a preacher. He's saying, I want to talk to you about your approach in ministry. And so we're going to read just a few verses here from verse number 14. He says there, neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by the prophecy with the laying on of hands of the presbytery. Meditate upon these things, give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. Well, here we are, we're servants of God. What are we going to do with it? I think the first thing here is a prompting. He says, I want you to neglect not the gift that is in thee. I believe when we were saved, every believer was given a spiritual gift. God enables us in certain areas of ministry. I believe that this passage is also dealing with the Holy Spirit himself. And I believe that God enables ministry by his Spirit. So what he tells Timothy to do is, I want you to stir it up, as he says elsewhere, stir up yourselves in the most holy faith. There needs to be a stirring up, a discontentment, a holy discontentment that says, I want more of God. I want more power from God. I want to be used greater by God. Sometimes we neglect that and we just get into cruise control. Have you been there? Let's be honest, we've all been there. When we're in cruise control, you may speak up or you may not, but even when you do, there's not really anything to it, is there? Have you ever shared the gospel in the flesh and you just know there's no power in it? And that's pretty difficult. In fact, you're right at the edge of where you're about to throw the towel in, because when it's like that, it's better not to share the gospel. We are failing because God's Spirit doesn't have access to us. How can he work through us if he's not working in us? And Paul says, preacher, don't forget the Holy Spirit must work through you. Neglect not the gift that is in you. Don't forget God's enabling is what this is about. Yes, it's a pretty exciting thing that I'm God's representative, but wow, what a responsibility that is. It needs to come with God's enabling. I need to be careful. And so I need to do some serious prompting of those things. Stir the fire. If you like to isolate this, and I don't think it is to be isolated, but let's suggest this talks about your quiet time, your time with God. When was the last time you got up and spent a real quiet time with God where you stirred the fire? And where you prayed and sought the power of God on your life. We wonder why we're empty as we go about our business. Maybe we haven't been stirring the fire. And that's not okay. because we are stewards of the mysteries of God. That's serious business. Stir your fire. Rekindle the fire. Take time to do it. Some prompting of things in your life. And then he goes on and he says, meditate on these things, verse 15. And here we get to preparation. Preparation. A prompting and a preparation. Meditate on these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all. Have we given serious attention to the things that we want to share? You know why we do the Bible doctrine course, don't you? It's not so you can become theologians. So that you know and understand what the Scripture says on different thoughts, so that you can share Christ. If we were to isolate things, and again, it's not just about isolating them. But verse 14 I would put down to our quiet time. Verse 15 I'm going to put down to study time. See, there's a time where I spend time just to be with God. One of the dangers of preachers is that we can do everything for study time because I want to get a message to preach, but I forget time with God. That's a dangerous thing for a preacher. But you know, just because I've spent time with God doesn't mean that I know the Scriptures and I can share them with others. We need to do some serious work. Learn your Bibles. Study the Scriptures. This is the preacher telling the preacher, don't slack off. Don't be a lazy bones. You're not ready to preach if you haven't been in your study preparing. And when it comes to our lives as servants of God, let's be real. You're not ready to face the guy with a thousand questions if you're not going to take time to learn something and to study your Bibles. Have a quiet time. Spend time with God. Spend time in prayer. Seek the Lord. But then take some time to do some study. It'll take you a little bit deeper. It'll connect Scriptures. It's not just reading your few verses and leaving it there. Meditate on these things. Connect the dots. One of the greatest things that happens as you read your Bible is when you're reading a passage here, wherever it might be, and you go, that reminds me of a Scripture over here. And when you can start drawing the Bible together, now that you're growing, you're learning, you're studying, and meditation will help you to do that. When you think on those things, when you consider where stuff fits. We've got people going into all kinds of doctrinal errors. And I'll guarantee you that one of the greatest reasons is laziness. They're not diligent in studying their Bible. And we need to know our Bibles and be so careful. There needs to be a prompting, a spiritual stirring. That'll happen in my quiet time. There needs to be some preparation. Getting in and studying out things, meditating on these things. Take some study time. And then there'll be some preservation. He says there in verse number 16, take heed to yourself. And what he's saying here is, before you preach to them, think about you. Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them. You continue in them. That thy profiting... Sorry, I skipped there. For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that hear thee. You want them to get the benefit? It's got to start here. We need to be working on letting God change me. There needs to be some spiritual safeguards put into our lives. And this is for all the time. Let God do it in you. I wonder, as a steward of God, if you would be accounted as a faithful steward. If God would say, yes, I'm satisfied they've done what I expected they should do. Or are we stewards that haven't put the effort in? Turn over to Proverbs 25 as we come to a conclusion there. It is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. I don't want my accountant giving me wrong perspective on the figures. I don't want to think things are good when they're not. And I don't want my preacher telling me it's okay when it's not. Proverbs 25 and verse 19, confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. One of those things that just goes right through you. That broken tooth, when you get an abscess behind your tooth or something like that, some of you have had it and you know what it feels like. And until that's dealt with, everything hurts. And it's hard to function. And here, the principle is, when we trust somebody but they weren't up to the task, it just messes everything up. I wonder if God were to look at us and say, well, I put this guy in as my steward, and I appointed him with the greatest job on the planet, and I fully authorized him. I gave him the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the power of God unto salvation. And I offered him all the power of God that comes with that. And I set him on a journey, but they never heard. Dare we be the broken tooth that impacts God and his objectives for us? I trust that you would say, I don't want to be a broken tooth. I don't want to be a foot out of joint. I don't want to be an unfaithful minister. I want to get serious about the job God's given us to do. As the ministers of Christ, I'm going to get serious. Let's do some prompting, stir the fire. Have a quiet time. Let's do some preparation. Get some spiritual sustenance happening. Get into a study time. Let's make sure there is preservation happening. Spiritual safeguards set in our lives, and that's for all the time. And let's be faithful witnesses of Christ. Let's pray. Father, it is a wonderful calling that you've given, indeed for preachers, but in principle for every Christian. As ministers of Christ, help us, Lord, to recognize what a privilege it is to serve, not a burden. And help us, Lord, to endeavor by your grace to be faithful, to meet with you, to know the power of God on our lives, and then to be able to share that with others, that others might know the gospel and be led to choose themselves the ways of God. So we ask that you'd use us, and we ask that you'd prepare us, and we thank you in Jesus' name.